All right, so now we are talking about exploitation. So going from the stage where we know about a system, how do we then actually get access to it? So this follows on very neatly from the things that we've covered previously. So we've talked about software vulnerabilities and malware and earlier in the semester. We then talked about scanning, like footprinting and scanning. So how do we actually do the information gathering to get information about a system that we're going to attack? And now this is kind of the big step where we actually take that information that we now know about those systems and actually break into the computer, is what we're going to be talking about this week. And then following that, obviously, is post-exploitation. So what can you actually do after you get access to it is a topic that we'll cover later. So this is the art of breaking into a computer system. So once an attacker, maybe you, have got information about a system, you can start to figure out what kinds of attacks that system is likely to be vulnerable to. So there's no point firing off Linux-based exploits against a Windows machine. It's not going to work, right? You're just wasting your time. What's not going to work generally is just firing everything off against a machine, because there's so many things that could go wrong. Like if you, new exploit code is released pretty much on a weekly basis, there's always something new. And what that means now is there are literally thousands of ways that we can attack a computer system. And it wouldn't be practical to actually try all of those things against every computer we come across, because it would just be an entire waste of time. And also, if you can imagine what it would look like to a network monitoring tool if suddenly you're just trying to attack, you try everything against every computer, it wouldn't take long before red flags would be, any IDS, intrusion detection system on the network would just go, you'd just light up, basically. So we want to be careful and also improve the chances that we'll actually be trying something that's actually going to work against the system. Having said that, another approach is if you really don't care. Say you're a malicious attacker and you are a one-trick pony. You learned what we taught you in week two or whatever, which is like one way of breaking into, for example, the Samba vulnerability, which was a Linux-based flaw that you guys took advantage of on that Metasploitable system. You could do that one trick thousands and thousands of times against thousands and thousands of computers. Chances are eventually you'll find a computer that does work against, and you will have owned a computer, which is all well and good, but it doesn't actually help us from a security point of view, because if we're going to test the security of a system, either as a white hat pen tester, so we've been paid to actually do ethical hacking to scan a system and write a report about what security problems there are, or if we are an advanced persistent threat, so we are someone who actually really wants to break into a particular system, we need to go about it a much more methodical way. So we need to look at the system, figure out what's going to work, and then actually try the sorts of things that are going to work against that computer system. So how do we know what's going to work? Well, personal knowledge, right? So as soon as you see a Windows 2000 system on a network, for example, RPC decom vulnerability is, quite likely to work against that system. It's a really old system sitting on the network. I know what's going to work, what kinds of things to try when I'm attacking that system. We can also look at databases of vulnerability. So we can look at online databases and also local databases, like from a program that has a list of attacks. And we can also start using automated tools. So we could use a tool that actually searches for attacks that are going to work, such as what's included in Metasploit. We might do some vulnerability scanning and assessment, which is an automated way of scanning for problems, or attack tools that can automate certain features. So I'll talk about each of those in a little bit more detail. So never underestimate how good it is to actually know stuff. And that's kind of like what, some people say, why do you have a closed book exam when in real life I can Google the answer to any question I ever get? Well, the answer to that I would say was, well, if you need to Google everything that you ever need to do, you're not going to get much done and you're not going to be very good at doing it. So actually knowing stuff, having information available in your brain is an important skill, because then you can actually do problem solving and build on top of that. I often resort to Google when I'm trying to find stuff out, but it's building on top of the things that, you know, the information about the problem. So it's like learning a new programming language, for example. If you've done a bunch of programming before and you know how they work generally, you know, it's very easy to quickly find out, oh, so how do I do this in this programming language? Whereas if you didn't know anything and you're just trying to Google everything, then it would be a very like difficult challenge. Say for example, you know that you're attacking a web server, you do a scan and you don't see port 80, then you would not, you'd think to yourself, well, maybe it's sitting on another port or something like that. So it's just kind of like the more you know, the more likely you're going to be able to problem solve correctly. But you're not going to know everything, right? No one does, as far as I'm aware. So you're not going to know, you know, to be fair, you're not going to know a lot. You're going to know the sorts of things that you might try first, but actually you're not going to know everything that's going to work against even a Windows 2000 server, because there's just so many different things you could try based on different configurations, what services are available. If you can see that there is a file share, maybe an FTP server, then that's kind of, you go down this whole rabbit hole of trying to find out more information about the attacks that are going to work against the various services and things that are on that system. So you can resort to, not resort, I mean, it's an important step is looking at databases of information. So often these databases will actually include exploit code. So for example, if you can see that there's a particular FTP server on the system, you can look in a database, you can look up that particular version of the software, and you might actually find there's an exploit sitting there that you can download and use to attack that system. So some example databases are Security Focus, which is really quite good, a lot of detailed information about different vulnerabilities, and often includes exploit code, and quite a lot of detail, and look at that. We'll look at that in a second. And the exploit DB, which is specifically focused on exploits rather than vulnerabilities. So for example, Security Focus might tell you about a security problem when there's no actual code that's released to the public on how to fix it, whereas the exploit DB will only tell you about exploit code rather than the problem itself. And there's something that links all these things together, which are CVE numbers, which we'll talk about in a minute as well. So Security Focus looks a bit like this, right? It's a website, it's pretty straightforward. If you go to the actual search feature for vulnerabilities, you can see here, you can specify the vendor, so in this case Microsoft, title and what the software is, and if you want to, you can go down even more specific and say which version, but if you don't know that, then I believe it will still give you information about everything it knows about different versions of Windows 2000 security problems. So, you know, you can basically look at the problems that exist, and you can see here there's a lot of pages of vulnerabilities that it knows for Windows 2000. And one specific example is RPC-DCOM vulnerability. So RPC-DCOM vulnerability is actually, it's a buffer overflow, so it's a particular kind of programming mistake where they haven't correctly allocated and checked that you're only working within a specific boundary, you know, of information, the size of the variable, basically. It was a problem that was introduced by, you know, Microsoft's programmers, you know, many years ago now, in Windows itself. So every single version of Windows, no matter what was installed on it, basically, as long as those ports were open, and you know, there wasn't a firewall there, which back then was not that unusual to not have a firewall set up properly. Basically, you can connect to that and take full control of that system. So if you will, and that's kind of rarer these days where we actually have an exploit in the OS itself. So it still happens, but it's just a little bit rarer. Often it's some software that's running on the operating system. So every now and then something will come up in the Windows kernel itself, but often it'll be something else. So for example, the recent one was various vulnerabilities in PowerPoint files that you could send a PowerPoint document, and that would get access to, like, admin access to the machine. And you know, things like Heartbleed are obviously their libraries on a Linux system. It's not the kernel itself, but there are, you know, OS things still do come up, but it's just a little bit rarer nowadays because they're getting a bit better at trying not to introduce security vulnerabilities. So if we look at this website, we can see information like, for example, here's a list, every single version of Windows that is vulnerable to this specific attack. So you could use this attack against someone using Windows XP. So if they haven't run all the software updates to, you know, past Service Pack 1, so if they're not on Service Pack 2 or later, then they'll be vulnerable to this exploit. A whole bunch of different ones. And then there's all these tabs with more information, right? So, which in this case includes actual download for an exploit you can run against it. So I was saying the glue that kind of joins all these discrete databases together is CVE numbers, or the one of the options. So common vulnerabilities and exposures, CVE, is basically, it's a dictionary for publicly known vulnerabilities. So it's public and free to use. That database itself doesn't really include any technical details or exploits, but it will give you links to other places where you can find that information. So, you know, it'll link from the CVE database out to these various databases that have more information about the security problem, but also the other way around, where each of these databases includes a CVE number. And obviously one of the advantages of doing that is, you know, people like to come up with their own catchy names for things. So if I just, especially this year, for some reason, everyone's naming all the exploits and vulnerabilities and things are getting catchy, you know, names like Heartbleed and Shellshock and Sandworm and stuff. You know, it's not always the case, right? Usually it's just a boring CVE number. I guess it makes it more like media friendly or something. But it's the thing that means that we can use the same name and we know that we're referring to the same thing, because there might, for example, there'll be a bunch of different PowerPoint vulnerabilities. And I think even this year there's been like, I don't know, at least three critical vulnerabilities found in PowerPoint. So if we don't have some way of naming them, each different problem, then how do we like find information about it on the internet? Or, you know, within these databases. That's what CVE does. So it's unique for a specific vulnerability, like security problem. And it means that we can share information a lot more easily. So CVE identifier is made up of the actual identifier number. And the example for RPC DECOM vulnerability is CVE 2003-0352. The CVE identifier will also include a very short description and references to where you can find more information. This year, the syntax actually changes so that we get a much bigger number because we can't fit all the vulnerabilities that are being discovered into, you know, 9,999 just wasn't cutting it for the amount of security problems that were being discovered every year. So, they could see that was going to overflow. So they basically come up with a larger number now, so you can actually accommodate a lot more vulnerabilities. So yay, we can, yeah. So CVE database itself is run by the MITRE Corporation, which is funded by Cybersecurity and Communications at the US Department of Homeland Security. If you want a new one, so say for example you discover a new vulnerability, then you can request a CVE number for this new vulnerability that you've discovered. So you can either do that through a CVE numbering authority, and they might make the announcement that the problem exists, or if you want, you can actually request a reservation that you can then use to publish the information so that, you know, you control when it goes public. So that's how that works. And if you do discover a new vulnerability, which many of you will go on to do because, you know, you're studying security and or forensics, so if later in your careers you do discover like a new vulnerability, then you can, or maybe for your assignment in final year, then you can actually go ahead and request a CVE number for it. And you get your name in the database, which is nice. So exploit code, if you look at these databases, often you'll have a proof of concept. So someone will have created the code to exploit that vulnerability. Again, it comes back to this debate that we were having, you know, a few weeks ago about what responsible disclosure is, and you know, when do you actually release the exploit code? But you know, it's basically the way that the industry works is at some point, exploits that vulnerabilities that have been discovered, quite often, exploit code will also be released either straight away if it's full disclosure. Or if they're following responsible disclosure, they might give the company some time to act before they release it. But you can find all these examples of code that you can use to attack different kinds of computer systems. Now, these exploits can be written in any programming language in the universe, so it doesn't really matter, right? It's just a, for example, the exploit might connect to a server and send something through which causes the server to break and you to get control of it, right? So it doesn't really matter what programming language you use to do the attack, because you know, you're sending stuff over a network or to a computer, right? But often, traditionally, they're written as C programs. So a little C program that basically was a standalone exploit. Often nowadays, you will find them written in Ruby, because that's the language used for Metasploit modules. So again, in your final year, you'll actually look at how to write your own Metasploit modules and things like that, but you can often it'll be written as a Metasploit module, but you'll also find Perl and Python and just like whatever people are familiar with. So what do you do if you find a standalone exploit? So say it's a C, written in C, you download that .c file. Often it'll just be a single file. It might be more complicated, but often than not, most exploits are just a single file. Download that, check it's compatible with your operating system. Obviously, you're not going to be able to compile a Windows exploit on a Linux system and vice versa. So basically, you just look at the headers in the C file. Does it look like a Windows is using Windows or Linux? That's usually pretty obvious, because it'll be like just the names of the header files that it's including. So that's like the first few lines within the C file. Then you compile it. So for example, use GCC and compile that program. This is stuff that you guys are going to do in the labs, so you know, it'll all make a lot of sense to you once you've actually done it. And then that creates the executable program, which is just a program that you run, and often it'll ask you who you're trying to attack, and then it'll do the attack, right? So obviously, if you're running an executable that someone else has created on your own system, as you will remember from week two when we were talking about malware, that can be a scary thought, right? So you're trusting, especially if you read that entire C program and you understand every single line in it, then you know, you're fine. But if you don't audit the code and you just compile it, then you could be running anything on your system. So if you're worried, you might want to put it in a virtual machine or a sandbox, just to kind of protect yourself against the exploit that you're firing off against the other machine, because you know, you might not be able to trust every single person that writes exploit code, but you know, maybe you do, but I wouldn't. So if you look at a standalone exploit, it's going to look like a bit like this. So this is a kind of a small section of this C code, and this is basically just a string that that's been defined within the code, and then there's all this information, which is basically the machine level instructions, so the machine code assembly instructions or whatever you want to call it, that gets fed into that computer over the network usually. So it's going to include this hard-coded information. So in this case, we've got a return address, and we've got this here is actually the payload. So there's a lot of 90s, which you'll know soon enough means no op, so it doesn't do anything. That's just a NOP slide. It runs through there and then hits the actual payload and does this. So this is the code that ends up getting executed on the system that you're attacking. So that's the payload. But you know, it's kind of, what if you didn't want a bind shell on port 4444 for this specific exploit? Well, you'd have to hack at the C code, and that may or may not be straightforward. You know, it might take a bit of like fiddling to get it to work with different payloads. But once you've run that, bam, pow, you've got your remote shell, right? So in this case, you'd run that program. It would, it would be a bind shell. So you'd have to connect into that on port 4444, and then you would then get, you know, prompted by, you know, more likely than not, like a command prompt window for whatever operating system you're attacking. So you might get the Windows command prompt or Linux command prompt, depending on what the target is. So that's all well and good, but it's kind of like not the ideal way of doing things, right? Like, you can imagine that's quite fiddly. The ExploitDB is a nice database where you can find exploits, basically. And there's actually the website you can visit, but also there's an offline version of it, so there's an offline repository. And if you've got Kali Linux, actually that includes a whole bunch of exploits from ExploitDB are sitting on your local system. So a lot of those exploits are just in this massive directory structure of .c files. So if you actually want to use them, you need to know how to search through that to find the exploit that's going to work, and then you need to compile it and run it, kind of thing. So there's the command searchsploit, which you can use within Kali Linux. And if you, for example, ran searchsploit Windows RPC decom, then it would come back with a list of .c files that you could actually compile in order to attack that vulnerability on a system. So again, that kind of simplifies things for us a little bit, but we're still compiling exploits, and if we want to change the payload and things, it's like quite fiddly. So that's where exploit frameworks comes in. So an exploit framework is basically, it helps simplify these things so that it's basically this powerful tool that we can use to combine attacks and payloads and basically pick and choose, and kind of like helps automate that whole process of attacking a system. So it kind of allows us to select and deploy exploits. So there's a few different ones out there that you can use. So there's Core Impact, and it costs around $30,000 a year for a single license of that, which is similar to Metasploit. It's like got a graphical interface and some reporting. They've actually updated it recently, well, I say recently, within the last few years, so that it can actually use Metasploit's exploits. You know, they used to say, oh, we're way better than Metasploit because, you know, we've got quality assurance on all our exploits and stuff like that. But in the end, they you can actually fire off Metasploit exploits and things from within that. So I guess they've realized that, why aren't we actually just taking advantage of all this huge, massive vulnerability exploit library that Metasploit has. There's Canvas, which is about $1,500 a year. And you can purchase additional exploit packs. And then there's Metasploit itself, which is awesome. It's the base itself is free. So the actual framework is free. All the exploits are more or less open source. So they're open source under the Metasploit license. But then there's like the professional version of Metasploit, which is basically just a nice fancy graphical interface on top of that. So it uses all the free open source part of Metasploit, and then it provides like a web interface to that and some extra automation features and things that you don't get in like the free version. And that costs about $15,000 a year for the professional version. But again, you can use... Sorry?
Is that per user or is that per...
I think it is, yeah. Yeah, we do have a license for it here and in the lab machines, and I think that you'll use the pro version in this module from memory. But we mostly use the MFS console, which is like part of the actual framework itself, because there's not really much you can't do from there. But it's just a shiny nice interface, and it can improve workflows, but whether or not that's worth $15,000 a year is, maybe it is, maybe it's not. Depends on your use case, I guess. So these are rough pricing estimates, because actually they don't publish the prices on the websites. So you have to like request a quote and stuff. And they may have altered since I collected this information, and you know, this is just a rough estimate. So Metasploit, the way Metasploit works is before Metasploit was released, standalone exploits was just the way things were done, right? So you would download individual exploits, and that was kind of the typical approach that you'd use. If you're doing a pen test against the system, you would basically download whatever exploits you needed to try and attack the system. You'd compile them and fire them off. But then in 2004, which isn't that long ago, H.D. Moore, Spoon M, gave a talk called Metasploit Hacking Like in the Movies. And it was a game changer in a way, because it suddenly made these kind of like, created this exploit framework, made it open source, freely available for people to use, and you know, they got a standing ovation at the end of their presentation, impressed a lot of people, because really you can do things like, oh, I'm going to use this exploit, this payload against this system with these settings, this IP address, and run it, and it just like, it's all order magic, and it gives you, you know, access to the system. But not only that, but if you are developing exploits, so you're writing your own exploits, it's a lot easier to do it on top of the Metasploit libraries than to just do it in pure C. Because, you know, if you look back at that slide earlier with all that basically machine code, that's just a huge chunk of code, Metasploit simplifies all of that, so you can actually just, you know, pull in the different libraries, and if you want an op slide, you just ask for one. You know, you can, it, all the library is incredibly powerful, so it makes it a lot easier to actually develop exploits. So yeah, it's a very powerful tool. And Metasploit contains over 1,000 exploit modules, so there's like, you know, over 1,000 ways that it knows how to attack a system. Having said that, if you are doing a security test, it still pays to check like ExploitDB and search through that database, as well as using Metasploit's vulnerabilities and exploits that it knows about, because, you know, it's not 100% complete, because there's all different ways you can attack the system as well. That is a very nice place to start. So you can actually import scan results from other tools. So if you use nmap to do your port scan, which you guys have done previously, and you'll do more in more detail this week. Last week. So last week, you know, you looked at all different kinds of nmap scans. So you can import all those results into Metasploit, and there's actually, you can import it from a tool. So nmap has various output features where you can output to like XML documents and various formats, and then you can import it directly into Metasploit. Or you can actually run the DB nmap scan from within Metasploit, and it runs nmap and automatically captures the output and stores it directly into Metasploit's database. And then from within Metasploit, you can like type hosts, and it will show you all the IP addresses that that have been discovered previously using nmap and things. And you can type services, and it will show you ports. So you can actually use that to like quickly get from a scan to you know, trying out Metasploit modules that are actually relevant and filtering down to modules that are likely to work. So also Metasploit includes its own scanners. So if you didn't want to use nmap for whatever reason, there's also port scanners and things within Metasploit framework. You know, that nmap is an incredibly powerful scanner. It's just, it's had so much work done on it that it's really good at what it does. So, you know, there's no reason not to use nmap, but if for whatever reason you wanted to use the ones in Metasploit, you can. But not only does it have port scanners and things, but it has kind of enumeration tools and all that sort of stuff built into to MSF as well. So if you were in Metasploit, you could kind of run these search commands as well to search through the database for vulnerabilities that might be relevant. So for example, search type colon exploit space platform colon Windows 2000 is going to actually bring back a list of all the Metasploit modules that are known to work against Windows 2000. So that's like quite a good thing, right? Or you can, if you know the CVE, you can quickly search for exploits that match the CVE. And that's basically going to tell you exactly what you need in order to attack a system if you already know what they're vulnerable to. Armitage is a very nice tool, and it's an alternative front end to Metasploit. So, you know, as I was saying before, Metasploit, the underlying platform is free, and then you can like pay to get access to the fancy features on top of that, like the graphical interface on top of that. Armitage is an alternative that's created by someone else, which is an open source front end to Metasploit. So you can use that instead of using Metasploit Pro. And it's unlike Metasploit Pro, which is like a web app, it is a like a graphical program, like desktop program kind of thing. And it's got some really nice features. So you can do things like have multiple users all working together to attack a system where you can like network into the one instance of the network, and it does like very nice graphical ways of representing all the systems it's discovered. So you can like visualize what the targets are. It can also recommend exploits, and it's got a Hail Mary attack where you can just launch a barrage of things, but it's usually not what you want because it's not very intelligent. It basically, if for example it sees an FTP server, it'll just try every FTP attack against that system. Again, if you're really stuck and you're not really worried about intrusion detection systems and things, then it can be like a nice way to just check, okay, I can see that port's open. Does Metasploit have anything that's likely to work? And you can just fire them all off. But in real life, it's probably not what you want. And if that's the way that you're going about your pen test, then you're doing it wrong. But it's quite a nice feature to have. So it looks a bit like this. So you've got modules. So you've got all of the exploits and everything all listed in here. You can visualize what your targets are. So it shows you like all the systems it's detected, and the red lightning bolt, you know, the red with the lightning bolts represents the fact that you've actually successfully exploited that system. So you've got some kind of control over that system, and you can do all sorts of clever things, pivoting and things like that. So it's quite nice. And then the bottom, actually the best feature, is it shows you exactly what it's doing in MSF console. So you can see all the commands that it's actually running. So this is just like a nice graphical interface to this tool that you would be using. It helps because it doesn't hide the details from you. So you can actually see what it's doing. So you can use the find attacks feature, and it actually filters down, suggests, it creates an attack menu. So you can right click on the target, and there'll be an attacks menu with all the attacks that are more likely to work. Again, it doesn't guarantee that they're going to work, but it sees that there's a likelihood that one of these is probably, you know, these ones are more likely to work than other ones. And you can actually, in Metasploit in general, there's a check exploits feature where you can check whether the exploit's likely to work without exploiting the system. Unfortunately, most exploits that are written don't include that feature. So sometimes the only way to know whether it's going to work is actually trying the exploit out, but it's something that you can try. So you can do check exploit, and it will tell you whether or not they're likely to work without actually exploiting the vulnerability. Hail Mary, as I said before, just tries everything it can think of, but it's not particularly clever. So for example, if you've got a web server that's not on port 80, there's quite a good chance that you won't even try those kind of attacks against it, because it'll miss the fact that that's there. So a human brain is obviously going to outthink these tools, but they're still, they're quite nice to have. So vulnerability analysis is kind of that next step, right? So it's one thing to be able to exploit a system, and it's also quite nice to be able to just like try everything against the system if we really wanted to know if a system was vulnerable. But what if actually we are an organization, we've got computers in our network, we want to know whether they're vulnerable, and we don't have the manpower for someone to actually look through every single database for every single port, do all that manually. So what a vulnerability scanner does is it tries to figure out in all likelihood whether or not something's vulnerable to particular kinds of attacks, and it does that in very clever ways. So it'll kind of like what Nmap does, it'll talk back and forth to the system, try and figure out what software is there, but it'll go that extra step. So for example, on Nmap, when you see that there's like a particular server running with a particular version, it then checks that, a vulnerability scanner will check that against a database to say whether that version is known to have vulnerabilities. So it basically gives you this very nice long report about all the things that it found and whether there were any security problems that it thinks that you have, without actually trying to attack the system. But it might try some things just to get as reliable information as it can without actually attacking the system. Because not every time, you might not be willing to try attacking a system, because often when exploits fail, they fail horribly and can just bring a server down. So if you try an exploit out, sometimes it all works really well and you just end up with a command shell and everything's fine and now you've got access and they don't know that you've got access and it's all, you know, wonderful. Other times things will go horribly wrong, and because the way these things work is they're basically making software misbehave and you might actually, you know, horribly crash a server and the whole server will come down. So vulnerability scanners usually try not to do that. They try and not kill everything, but just try and figure out what's likely to work. But there's going to be a lot of false positives, right? So it's not going to be 100% accurate, because it's just trying its best without doing everything it can, kind of thing. It does what it can without breaking things to give you a general idea about whether there are security problems. And it's not going to give you as much detail as if you do a proper pen test where you say, go for it, try and hack into the system and see what you find. But it will give you like quite a good overview of your systems. So it's kind of automated and a bit shallower. But also nice and consistent because it's all automated. So if you run that same software against another server, it's going to do exactly the same stuff. You can call that vulnerability scanning or vulnerability analysis or assessment. All those terms mean basically exactly the same thing. They're just different ways of saying the same thing. So it does network scans, it'll do port scanning, it does service identification. It'll check whether it's annoying to have vulnerabilities. It compares detected versions of databases. It might do a bit of probing of the system. And sometimes there'll be like a safe mode, or you can turn that off. So for example, you could say, just try everything. I don't mind if it kills the server. I'd much rather know if there's a problem. So that they often have that option. But they can be really expensive tools, but they're pretty much required. If you're doing proper, if you're an ethical hacker and you're doing penetration testing and security auditing, you probably need to front up and pay for one of these tools, because it's just gonna make your life so much easier. You can get evaluation versions if you want to try it out, and there are often home versions. So if it's not for commercial use, you can get free versions off the internet. So Nessus is basically one of the most popular vulnerability scanners that exists. It used to be open source, but they changed their mind about that a few years ago. So they closed it off. It's a client server system, so you've got a server that does the vulnerability scanning and you've got a client that connects in and controls the vulnerability scanning process. And it's relatively affordable compared to some other tools. It has its own scripting language that you can use to write attacks and tests and things. There are feeds of tests that you can get. So there's the home feed or like the professional feed. And often these sorts of things, there'll be like a delay. So if you get the free version, you might just get the same thing everyone else does, but with a 1 month delay, so that if there are brand new security problems, you don't find out about them unless you're paying for like the most up-to-date version of the database. And there are different scanning profiles. So you could do like a compliance scan, and it will actually, some of these scans are quite advanced and they'll actually log into the system. So you might have some scans will actually remotely log into the Windows systems within your network and then carry out more tests about the software running on those systems and report back about whether you're compliant with various security policies and things. But you can also do like external scans, so like assuming that you don't have access to the network. You can do internal scans. There's all these different profiles you can choose, so it's quite nice. OpenVAS, because it used to be open source software, Nessus was, when they closed it off, obviously they can't take away the stuff they've already released open source. So OpenVAS is basically carrying the torch of the previously free version of Nessus. So Nessus has actually moved on in a lot of ways. They've kind of rewritten a lot of their code. OpenVAS is based on the older version. But it's still quite a nice thing, and still used by a lot of security companies that provide pen testing and things as like a free alternative to Nessus. So OpenVAS is still maintained and available. It's just, you know, whether or not the actual database of scans it can do is quite as good. Well, I mean, I don't know the answer to that, but I would guess it's probably not quite as complete as Nessus's is, because they don't have as many people working on it. But it's still a very nice piece of software that you can use to scan a system for vulnerabilities. Some of the other versions you can use are as Retina, Nexpose is by Rapid7. So the guys that now own Metasploit have their own vulnerability scanner, which we also have a license to. That has one of the nice things about that, and most of them actually have quite good integration with Metasploit. So I think the same with Nessus. If you do find a vulnerability, you can often fire up Metasploit and actually attack it to test whether or not it's really true or whether it's a false positive. Nmap actually is not only a scanner, but it can do some vulnerability scanning as well. There are some advanced tests that Nmap can do, and some of those include actually vulnerability scans and things against specific vulnerabilities. So that's quite nice as well. Because these things rely on the open source tools and things, most of the vulnerability scanners have quite a good integration with Nmap to bring in port scanning results and Metasploit to actually try out and find out whether what it's detected is true. There's all kinds of different tools that you can choose. So, that worked out quite well time-wise. So in conclusion, once an attacker knows all the details about a system, there's ways that you can find out what exploits are going to work. And once you know that, you can actually exploit the system. And typically, after running an exploit, you'll end up with some kind of control over the system. So there's some risk that you'll actually harm the system. You might break things, so just be careful. Only attack things when you have permission, obviously. And vulnerability scanners are a nice kind of quick way to test the security of a system, but it's a bit less risky, but also it's a bit shallow and it might give you false positives or false negatives. So thank you very much. See you later.
Cheers.
See you guys.